Welcome to Global Connections in an Era of Skepticism, an event that we are co-hosting with the Technology Policy Institute, led by Scott Wolfson. We put together this event because we believe in the importance of the global economy for America's future. The current mood of skepticism is understandable. It's there for real reasons, but we believe it's a mistake. Having said that, we also believe that it's critical, absolutely critical, to move away from outmoded categories. The concepts of exports and imports were appropriate for the industrial economy of the 20th century. But in the 21st century, we need to broaden our vision to other types of connection with the rest of the world, including investment, cross-border flows of data, and other intangibles and movements of people. PPI itself has recently gone global. We opened an office in Brussels, and we made global public policy a big part of our portfolio. We are glad to partner on this event with the Technology Policy Institute, a think tank that focuses on the digital economy in the US and around the world. As you may have noted, our opening speakers come from both sides of the aisle. Debates over policy are healthy, but it's also important to show that there is bipartisan support for staying connected with the global economy. So let me welcome my co-host, Scott Wolfson.
Thanks, Michael. Just quickly, I'm Scott Wolfson, president of the Technology Policy Institute. We're delighted to host this event at the Progressive Policy Institute. And we're especially honored to have Congresswoman Susan Chalbany as our opening speaker. She represents Washington's first congressional district, first sworn into the House of Representatives in November of 2012. She currently serves on the House Ways and Means Committee and House Budget Committee. She also serves as vice chair of the New Democratic Coalition. Please welcome Susan Chalbany.
Good morning, everyone, and thanks for having me. And I'll walk all the way over to the Senate side. So, I come from Washington State. I represent one of the most beautiful areas of the country, and it's just east of Seattle, and it's home to a very diverse economy, to technology, medical devices, services. The district that I represent goes from the Cascade Mountains out to the water and all the way up to the Canadian border. So those of you who haven't been there, I call our Washington the better Washington because it's beautiful and a lot of great innovative things are happening in Washington State, but we are also the most trade-dependent state in the country. 40% of our jobs are tied to trade, and my district is one of the top 10 most trade-dependent districts in the country. And I think four of the top 10 are in Washington State. And my district does have a little bit of everything, and so it's pretty representative of many differing points of view, but it's also the home of Microsoft, the home of a large amount of aerospace, including Boeing employees, a large Google campus, a factory that makes Sonic Air toothbrushes, thousands of farms that grow fruits and vegetables, and dairy farmers. And I also represent many rural communities that traditionally were timber towns and are struggling today. Up north, we have two refineries and an aluminum smelter. So it truly is a diverse region and a diverse district. But trade has been critically important and really means jobs in my district and our region. And so it's an important example of why trade is so important and something that's been missing in our trade debate recently. Today, when we see a picture of a shuttered factory, something that had been a previously thriving company, a manufacturing company, the first assumption is that the culprit is trade and trade alone. And while trade policy is an important part of the conversation and needs to be part of the solution, it does not represent the whole story. There are winners and losers in trade, but there hasn't been really recognition of the other economic and technological forces that are at hand. So we think of innovation, and innovation is common in our area. We think of it as something that happens in Silicon Valley and Seattle, but not in rural America. And I can tell you, and my district's a great example, that innovation is happening all across our country. urban and rural economies are being disrupted by innovation, and we need policies that help Americans and the world adapt to these new economic realities. Not only is this good for large companies in my district, but also very much so for small businesses who are using the internet to connect with customers all around the world. We don't often think of agriculture when we should, when we're talking about innovation and the internet. I started in Congress serving on the Ag Committee and had a chance not only to work with farmers in my region, but farms across the country. We talk about things like internet-connected cows and other internet-enabled devices for nutrient recovery systems, digesters for energy, drones that are making farms smarter, more profitable, Internet of Things sensors to figure out how much chemical you should apply, how much water you need so that we're using resources efficiently. Farmers are using online prices and sellers more and more. And just as many rural communities have lost their economic viability, if they weren't connected to the interstate highway system in the last century, the economies of small towns across America would struggle. And they're also dependent on access to the internet. So it's very hard to open a new factory or even a coffee shop if you don't have access to the internet. And it's a critical piece of infrastructure. And we don't always talk about the internet as infrastructure, but we should. It's not kind of a nice to have anymore. It's a must have and a basic foundational element for our economy. So one farm in my district, the Skagit River Ranch, it's about an hour and a half north of Seattle. They've grown their business over 17 years by selling organic Wagyu beef through the internet. They're an incredible example and story. If you're ever up in Skagit County, you should go meet with them. But during the debate over trade promotion authority and during the last Congress, and increasingly during the course of the presidential election, trade was made out to be the cause of all of our economic ills, while other economic forces like automation, lack of skills training, and outdated tax policies were barely acknowledged. There's been too little recognition of the need for greater enforcement of trade standards and the need for tax reform. Trade agreements can have the highest possible standards imaginable, but until the incentives are taken away to move jobs overseas, there will still be one to do so. And that's really more about tax policy. Trade done right and enforced properly can open up new markets for American products, encourage job growth, and maintain U.S. leadership on the global stage. There's no reason we need to close our doors and shut ourselves off from the rest of the world. Unfortunately, the rhetoric that we've heard and those whose voices have been the loudest have deeply permeated the conversation across our country, contributing to an increasingly nationalistic and protectionist faction. An obsession with trade deficits misses the forest for the trees. And so far, the new administration has been long on rhetoric, but very short on specifics. It's critical that we tell the entire story. So as a new member of the House Ways and Means Committee, I've been an advocate for trade policies that support America's working families, that open up new markets for American products, while promoting the digital economy and innovation. Just recently, I co-founded the Bipartisan Digital Trade Caucus with Congressman Eric Paulson to ensure that we have continued American leadership in the digital economy. And frankly, it's critical that we educate members of Congress about a side of trade that isn't often discussed or understood nearly enough. We find with a lot of technology issues that education is really important because these aren't necessarily partisan issues, but one of the biggest challenges we have is people understanding them. Hundreds of thousands of small businesses in nearly every sector and in every congressional district in the country are harnessing the power of the internet and technology to reach new markets and to reach new customers around the world. So ready or not, the internet has changed the game and the way the world trades. And it's changed the way that we work and the way that we work together. Today, people are working collaboratively in different countries on a single product that isn't physical or tangible in a lot of cases. And this helps drive trade policies that are more inclusive. Digital trade promotes innovation and is a key driver of economic growth, accounting for more than half of the U.S. services exports. The U.S. runs a massive $159 billion trade surplus in digital services, and is responsible for nearly 6.7 million jobs. In my district alone, the services economy represents over 250,000 jobs and nearly 75% of exports. Yet data localization and other restrictive digital trade barriers abroad are impeding U.S. exports, threatening the promise of digital trade to expand U.S. businesses and strengthen workers. Regardless of how you felt about the Trans-Pacific Partnership, or TPP, the agreement made landslide strides on digital trade, locking in the importance of cross-border data flows. And as we look towards a possible renegotiation of NAFTA, it's important to remember that no one was talking about digital trade 25 years ago, and so these issues didn't exist. And so there aren't any digital trade standards to speak of. Congress should encourage and support policies that ensure information flows freely across borders, uncovered by restrictions that are fundamentally inconsistent with the free and open nature of the internet. Congress should also make it easier for businesses of all sizes to use the internet to trade their goods and services by reducing barriers wherever they exist, including customs. Trade has gone digital, and the world just works differently today than it did 20 or even 5 years ago, and we can't keep making assumptions based on outdated models. And that's a general statement I'll make about policy, is that we have many policies in place that are based on an economy that, 30-plus years ago, and we need to make sure policies are up to date with the way the world works today and the way it's heading in the future. The internet is already a global phenomenon, interspersed in nearly every activity. Protectionist policies will only damage the United States' standing in the world and leave us behind the digital curve. So the trade and the internet are interwoven, and one affects the other. It's my hope that lawmakers from both sides of the aisle will come together and support policies that reflect the way the world works today and ensure that America stays a leader on the global stage. If we don't, countries like China will gladly take our place. We need to be forward-looking in our approach to solving these problems, and retreating to policy of the past will not advance our economy and really aren't applicable to the issues that we face today. Trade does mean jobs, and we need to have a more nuanced discussion on how to raise standards, how to raise enforcement standards while promoting innovation, dealing with the downside of innovation's disruption in the economy, like automation, and promoting American products and services around the world by updating our tax and our trade policies to better deal with the challenges of today and tomorrow. So thank you for inviting me and allowing me to speak with you today. I look forward to continuing on this work together, and I'm happy to take questions, or I also always say I'm happy to take your answers too, so you can tell me what you think we need to be doing. Please, anybody?
I have a question about
yes.
a question. Will you take questions after this is over in front of a camera?
We're doing right now. I might have to go to a meeting quickly after this. So if you have a question right now, I'll ask.
My cameraman's outside. No cameras allowed in here.
Oh. I just meant that, right here. I'm looking at my staff because they're the ones who have to tell me what I have to get to next. So they're going to rush me out here, I'm sure. But if you have a question right now, I'm happy to answer.
I have a less meta question.
Yeah.
So what do you think, in every election, trade is often portrayed as something bad. So in elections, trade is often portrayed as something bad. And yet the trend has always been sort of in the right direction. How do you see now, do you think we've actually seen, are we actually at a turning point where trade will be considered harmful in the long run, or will you be able to help turn things around? Or are you more optimistic that trade will be seen in a better light?
Well, I think, as I was mentioning, we kind of put everything under the umbrella of trade when we were talking about impacts of globalization, but also impacts of innovation, impacts of tax policy. And I think what we need to do is talk about what our goals are. Our goals are to make sure we have a strong, thriving U.S. economy, we have opportunities for workers right here in the U.S., and we need to look at all of the issues that impact that. And those issues we talked about, they come up a little bit when we talk about tax reform. I'm surprised that tax reform hasn't been a stronger part of this conversation, because money parked overseas, a lot of that has to do with tax policy. That's not a trade issue alone, and if we're talking about jobs here in the U.S., we should absolutely be talking about that and realizing what a priority that is. We need to talk about the importance that exports have had. My state and my district are good examples where the ability to export has a huge positive impact on our economy. And so we need to have that conversation and make sure people are informed of that conversation. And then include the changes that are coming with respect to the digital economy and how conversations around digital trade and frankly just digital policy going forward impacts our entire country, not just in areas that we think of as technology-rich areas. So that's going to be important, and I know that it's been a very kind of narrow conversation today. We need to make sure we're broadening and pulling all that information in. Some of us were talking about that a little bit before, and I know the panel will be talking about that more, but that's going to be a key component. When I talk about the digital trade caucus, part of the purpose of the caucus is to inform legislators and staff and others about kind of how things are, what's happening today, where things are headed. Congressman Daryl Issa and I started the Internet of Things Caucus for a similar reason, to talk to people about technology, what the Internet of Things is doing, what's happening today with new sensors and connected devices, and also talk about where that's headed. So part of what's kind of important is to educate, make sure people are up to date on where things are today, where they're headed, so that our policies can be forward-looking.
Do you see the renegotiation of NAFTA as a positive for U.S. relations with Mexico and Congress?
Well, I think, you know, when we talk about renegotiation of NAFTA, and then we'll see kind of where that's headed. We're waiting to see whether or not there's a letter coming that would kind of say that the administration is looking towards officially reopening NAFTA. When we talk about things like digital trade, those are areas, as I said, that weren't covered 25, weren't on the, even on the radar 25 years ago. So it's important, and we have the opportunity to bring up new issues like that and make sure we're addressing those issues in trade agreements going forward. And that's absolutely something that I think will be important, potentially in NAFTA, but also in other agreements as we either renegotiate or open new agreements.
Yeah, first of all, Congresswoman, thank you for your remarks. I have a question and kind of a suggestion, and it has to do with younger Americans. Millennials are digital natives, and surveys also show that they're much more positively inclined toward trade and global connections than folks my age. The question is, what can you and your colleagues in the caucus and on the Hill do to reach out to younger Americans to convince them that this is important? Because to me, in many ways, that's how we're going to get our policy right in the long run.
Well, I think so I'll give you a good example of something that is less a trade issue, but is an example where policy is out of date with technology, and many people don't realize the inconsistency, which has been on privacy. We have the Electronic Communications Privacy Act that was written in 1986, and you don't need a warrant to access digital information in the cloud in the same way that you need a warrant to access this piece of paper in my file drawer. Most people assume that our standards, our warrant standard would be, and privacy would be consistent on digital information like it is on physical information. Well, people didn't know. You know, there's an assumption, and when you talk about the fact that our policy is inconsistent there, young people are surprised because they just assume that, of course, we would have consistent policy across the board. So we need to highlight some of these places where policy is inconsistent between the physical world and the digital world, and highlight that's there so people are engaged in helping solve that problem. And that's why education is so important, because there might be assumptions are made, and then people can help us tackle those. And they're going to come up one way or the other. The question is, can we be more proactive than addressing a 1986 issue here in 2017? And some of the issues are going to be more complicated too, because you want to put a policy in place that isn't out of date tomorrow, you have to be forward-looking, and we need to be better stewards of policy, I would say, not just do policy, leave it on the shelf for 30 years and assume that it's good. We need to keep things more up to date, see what's working, what's not working, and be more proactive about how things are changing and making sure policy's working in our current environment. Yeah.
Thank you. So my name is Carl Schoenander. I'm with the Software and Information Industry Association. You actually came to speak to our members, so I thank you for that. And I also thank you for your leadership on these issues. You mentioned the Trans-Pacific Partnership, and you mentioned that whatever you thought about it, it had good digital trade provisions. Couldn't agree more with you on that. I'm wondering if you have any thoughts on, you know, given the fact that TPP as such is not going forward, whether you have thoughts on how we can make those digital provisions a sort of international default standard going forward?
Well, we did, as the Ways and Means Committee, we met with Secretary Ross earlier this month, and one of my questions for him was, would you use the cross-border data flows and the language from TPP? Would that be kind of a standard for you in future negotiations on other treaty agreements? And he seemed to indicate that that would be a good starting point. So that's important because a lot of work went into those particular provisions to work that out. And so if that's a starting point, that might serve us well. Clearly, as folks look at what happens with the EU and a lot of conversations we've had around safe harbors, that's going to also be an important conversation. And again, to your point, hopefully we can come up with a standard that is used internationally in a lot of ways that keeps the free flow of information, that we address cross-border data flows, that we address issues like data localization and other areas that have been of great concern. So that's been part of that, but I guess the kind of starting point today would be that language from TPP.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Congresswoman. Switch the name there. So Chairman Royce will be joining us a little bit later. Just after, right after me. I guess he wasn't stopping the way. The global economy used to be very simple. We made an airplane or a computer here or grew wheat, shipped it to there. They made a car, piece of clothing there, shipped it to here. Nobody was confused. We knew where it was, went across the border. It made sense to focus on exports and imports of goods, and that's what the trade statistics were designed to measure. That's what trade policies were supposed to address. But these days, countries are connected by far more than flows of goods. Companies easily provide services to customers in other countries without actually anybody having to leave their office. Foreign investment is increasingly important, with foreign companies investing in the US and US companies investing abroad. Cross-border flows of information and entertainment are soaring at incredible rates and barely measured by the economic statistics. To an increased extent, the cross-border flows here are intangible and a very different form than they had before. Now, it's important to remember that most of these cross-border connections are enabled by the internet. New undersea cables are being built all the time. The flows are just increasing at incredible rates. But at the same time, when we think intangible, we can't just think about the internet. The real world is important as well. People still want to talk to other people face to face, which means the ability to travel, easily travel to other countries, is crucial for being linked together. It's far easier for a German company to invest in a manufacturing plant in Ohio if there are direct flights, say, from Frankfurt to Cincinnati, and if it isn't a big pain to cross the borders. That's a matter where policy can be a tremendous help. So this is why we frame the trade issues. We've shifted our focus from trade to talking about global connections. This is not simply a semantic change. It really indicates a change in the way the global economy works. It indicates a change in the way we have to think about
our relationship to global economy. So what do global connections buy us in the US? What do they buy the person living in Ohio or in Nevada or Minnesota? Well, obviously, the ability to tap into foreign markets is very important. And that's always been the main argument for trade policy. But we have to remember that global connections also enable us to take advantage of the knowledge and smarts in other parts of the world. Other countries have higher savings rates than the US, which is why it's logical to welcome foreign investors. And work by the McKinsey Global Institute suggests that global connections boost growth for everyone. And now we come to the question of policy. Now, we've just gone through a seismic change in trade policy, where the administration has dropped trade agreements that have taken a lot of hard work, and is now talking about reopening NAFTA in an unpleasant way. But we have to realize that we didn't get to this place accidentally, that we have to start talking about trade policy, not just in terms of trade agreements that bring down trade barriers and facilitate exports and imports of goods. We have to talk about bringing down trade barriers for intangibles. We have to talk about policies overseas that block the flow of digital trade. And what we also have to realize is that to take full advantage of global connections, we have to build up our capacities at home. It isn't true anymore that you can segregate trade, the global economy, from the domestic economy. The two are interspersed together. Almost everything that we do at this point is touched by the global economy. Let me give you one example, and I think that Ed Berman will probably talk a little bit more about this later. If we introduce small businesses to global markets, it helps not just them, but it helps their local communities as well. It creates demand, it creates connections. That means that you have one business that connects into the global economy, the one next to them can too. The easier it is to sort of make these connections, the easier it is to get growth in the future. You're no longer restricted by your local markets. That's one important thing. Another important thing is making sure that we have sufficient internet connectivity outside of the big cities. It's essential for increasing digital literacy so that workers and business owners are able to take advantage of the global economy. It's historically been true that the big companies have been the big traders, and those have been the companies that have been most concerned with the global economy. But we have to sort of broaden things so that more people see the benefits. And I'm going to cite one statistic which is usually not cited in these discussions. As of 2016, there were 131 million valid U.S. passports in circulation. The number of Americans over the age of 16 is roughly 250 million. So roughly about half of Americans have passports. What this means is that half of Americans have no direct experience of the global economy. To them, it's something different than outside of them. We have to think about how to make sure that Americans have much more exposure to other countries. It's not simply a matter of travel or culture. This is a matter of making sure that people understand that we're all on the same page here. And so, really what I'm making is two points. One is an economic point about the importance of global connections, but also making a cultural point too. We are part of the global economy. We have to behave like we're part of the global economy. And rather than sort of trying to run away from it, we have to run towards it. Thank you very much. Just in time for our Chairman Royce, let me just do a quick intro. Chairman Royce serves California's 39th Congressional District. Since January 2013, he has held the position of Chairman of the House Foreign Affairs Committee. and he's also a senior member of the House Financial Services Committee. Please welcome Chairman Mercy.
Thank you. Well, let me begin by thanking all, and especially the Technology Policy Institute and the Progressive Policy Institute, for putting on this forum and giving us all a chance to express our views on this. And as Chairman of the Foreign Affairs Committee, I will just share with you, I have been involved in a lot of these arguments over liberalization, and certainly hearing from my constituents and trying to walk them through the consequences. To try to explain to people that our economic strength and national security are linked is a little bit of a challenge in today's environment. But I will tell you that when you walk them through the experience of what happened as a consequence of the Spoonhauer tariff, especially the commentary of President Hoover at the time, and was petitioned by economists left, right, and center and asked, do not do this. It was overwhelmingly popular in the House, and publicly popular. The Senate was a very close vote. But the aftershocks, the after effect, you can grab, if you want, on Blackboard, and you can show people year by year the declining amount of world trade. And for those of us who have understood how trade, international trade, has empowered people and created these niches around the world, you get a very clear understanding of why that international depression, why that Great Depression, was made so much worse by the policy decision at the time to erect such high tariffs and for states around the globe to double down on a tariff war. And you would think that the takeaway from that would be for all of us that study it or understand the consequences geopolitically to what happened in Europe, Asia, and around the globe afterwards, is to go out and try to get people to understand that we don't really have the choice of erecting those kinds of barriers. And that's why I really want to thank you for creating the forum here. Yes, you're focused on a lot of the positive developments that are going to come out from this interconnectivity. But every now and then, again, it's good to remind people that we have tried the opposite approach for those citizens who raise their hands and say, can't we just trade with ourselves? Start down this road. It is beneficial to walk through what some of those consequences were. Then there's this question that I originally raised here, which is what happens when the United States takes a step back from the world and disengages? And what happens when we're not asserting our interests in trade agreements in terms of market access? What happens when there's more than one idea out there about how to do trade? We're selling a certain concept on the world stage. It's high standards. It's to ensure a level playing field. Those are the agreements. And that level playing field works well for American job creators. But there's this other alternative. Trading with no standards. Let somebody else take the wheel and sell that concept. And that also has a very consequential impact when you have a major player that believes the rule of law is unimportant. And you start thinking through all of the consequences in terms of intellectual property theft, indigenous invasion, all of the bad ideas that gain ground when we are not on offense explaining our concepts on high standards. And you have some confusion out there. We did lose 5 million manufacturing jobs since 2000. But U.S. exports of goods reached an all-time high in 2014, and it was $1.4 trillion. It was quadruple where we were, a little more than a generation prior. So clearly there's another factor to this, and that factor is technology and efficiency. And that's playing a role in terms of some of the outcomes that we've seen here. But as we look at future negotiations with those that we trade with, we've got to update our agreements to meet the needs of today. And yes, we have to make certain that they are fair for our workforce. And we have to make certain that they are focused on tomorrow's economies, right? So we've got to ensure these fair deals, as I talked about, with high standards, while continuing to invest in technology to help create the good-paying jobs of tomorrow. This is an area where there's some good news and bad news. I'm from California. I represent a district primarily in North Orange County and part of East San Gabriel Valley. And Los Angeles is turning out more engineering graduates than any other city. But at the same time, my wife taught at Cal Poly Pomona, so I know something of the struggle as the pressure is on in terms of these science labs, engineering labs, to shrink that course curriculum and to expand the social sciences, because in the academic sector, that's very popular, and they're frankly less expensive to teach that kind of coursework. Now here's the difference. In my state, California, I know what the numbers are gonna be in terms of demand for STEM degrees. So if we follow down that course and we prepare many more multiples of students in the social sciences area where they do not have the potential for job opportunities, and we stint in the university setting the opportunities or even the preparation of junior high students and high school students to sort of channel them into an interest in the STEM, then basically we're going to have a circumstance where a lot of those jobs we're going to be short in terms of qualified people who understand these disciplines. But it's going to be a disservice to that generation of young people. I can't tell you how many university professors I've heard opine on this, but we're having trouble with the academic senates and so forth in terms of their attitude, which is across purposes. So I just raise that because I think we have an opportunity here. If we reflect for a minute, well, in California, we're competitive because we, like the rest of the United States, we're number one, worldwide, in terms of the patents we file, and that's because of the graduates we have in STEM, right? And by the way, if we do a little bit more on the artistic side, somebody with a music degree and a STEM degree, we can just about guarantee, based on the stats, that individual is going to file a great number of patents and create a lot of jobs and opportunities for others. So, and in terms of digital trade, this is key to our future prosperity. Over the last 5 years, the internet industries comprise tens of thousands of interconnected networks run by service providers, individual companies, universities, and others, and that has contributed more to our GDP than any other major industry. The information and communications technology sector of our economy since 07 has doubled. A World Bank, it's 6% by the way of the economy. That's just shy of $1 trillion in the economy. The World Bank found that a 10% increase in broadband penetration correlates with a 1.3% increase in GDP. To quote Einstein on compounding, I mean, this is very, very consequential. I think he once put that compounding was the most powerful force in the universe. Well, you know, it is very impactful in terms of what it does to create opportunities for upward social mobility. And for those of us in the US, it's been that opportunity for upward social mobility that for generations has sort of driven the American dream and driven our hopes for the next generation. Global data flows have grown 45-fold over the last decade. The Department of Commerce says that digitally delivered services account now for more than half of all U.S. services trade. And that's why we're insisting on strong U.S. negotiating objectives related to digital trades and goods and services and cross-border data flows in the trade promotion authority signed into law last Congress. But the importance of these connections goes far beyond business and economics and national security. And I'd just like to talk for a minute about this. I've been in most of the developing countries in the world, certainly most of the countries in Africa. I chaired that subcommittee for 8 years. And I can tell you, the internet has allowed billions of people to freely connect, to share ideas, to engage in commerce on a global scale, and it has the potential to do a lot of good. I'm the author of the Digital Gap Act, which we passed out of the House. We've got it in the Senate. We're getting close to getting it to the President's desk. We've worked on it for a couple of years. That's going to expand internet access in developing regions and in turn improve education. Obviously, it's going to empower a lot of women. So you've got 60% of the world's population that still lacks access to the internet. That's 3 billion people that have been left out of the biggest technological revolution of our time, 3 billion more being denied the benefits of the free flow of information, the benefits of the game-changing revolutions we see in health, in education, in commerce. And from the standpoint of business, that's 3 billion consumers that don't have access to American goods and services. So I'm going to leave you with a story based upon personal observation. This has to do with Liberia. And it has to do with the consequences of absence of connection. So several years ago, I visited Liberia. And there was a $100 million USAID project where we were digging massive trench and laying road. But there was one thing absent from that equation. And for those that you know something about the situation in Liberia, there's little access to any kind of connectivity across Liberia. So had those donors had the foresight to just invite the private sector in. The private sector would have laid fiber optic right along that road while it was being constructed. And here's why it's important. It takes us back to 2014. Ebola was ravaging Liberia. It was a crisis. 10,000 people had perished over the course of a single year. It crossed international borders. It reached the United States. There was a reason why the information did not get out. And that reason was because there was no access to the internet from the rural areas where Ebola struck in that region across Liberia. And that was the same region that I had visited where the road was being laid so many years before, and that information could have come instantaneously instead of by people walking out of that region eventually to tell that story. And that is what I was told by the physicians on the ground in Liberia. Donors and community health centers struggled to track the disease as it spread. They could not even coordinate their efforts with each other in that environment. Global connections and trade matter for many of the reasons that you've discussed here. for human connection, for information sharing, for global health, obviously, and for catalyzing innovation to spurring economic growth, job opportunities, that opportunity for the next generation of youth. So let's build communities and trust between countries through promoting trade and through both promoting technology like you're doing. And thank you very much for sharing, giving me the opportunity to share my thoughts today. I appreciate it.
The panelists.
Talking a little bit more detail about trade and services. I think that there is a large unrealized opportunity in trade and services. The service sector is large. Most people readily acknowledge that the United States is a service economy, but I'm always struck when you probe people for how big is it? You know, in terms of the labor force, well, it's big. Depending on how you measure it, it's, you know, north of 80% of employment. And close to the same share of GDP. So that's almost too big to talk about. So what I'd like to do is talk about a slice of the service sector that I'm going to call business services. And for you data nerds out there like me, I'm going to talk about the North American Industrial Classification System industries that start with a five. So this is the name's 50s. And it's the information sector, so it's publishing, software, movies, sound recording, and anything internet-related, telecommunications-related. It's finance, insurance, professional scientific and technical industries, so think architects, engineers, attorneys, accountants, and it's administrative support. Now, you might think that that's a niche sector. How big, what share of the labor force could that be? It's almost 25% of labor force. In contrast, the manufacturing sector, which we talk a lot about, and I think that this administration, as did the last administration, has a manufacturing fetish. The manufacturing sector is 8% of the labor force. So business services that I want to talk about, it's three times the size in terms of employment of the manufacturing sector. It's not only bigger, it's grown faster. Wages are higher. Average wages in this business service sector are 22% higher than average wages in manufacturing sector. Okay? In addition, many business services are tradable. Okay? Official statistics, we do a poor job of measuring the service sector in general compared to either the manufacturing sector or agriculture. But in terms of international trade, we do a particularly bad job in services. Just as a factoid, the Census Bureau publishes every month trade for 10,000 product categories with every country in the world. In contrast, the Bureau of Economic Analysis produces service statistics for a select group of countries quarterly for 30 categories. Just to remind you, services employment makes up 80% of the economy. Manufacturing makes up 8%. 80. So the allocation of resources to measuring the economy are off. So in previous work that I've done, I try to develop a methodology to identify what's tradable using existing data. And based on the calculations I've made, there's more employment in tradable business services than in the entire manufacturing sector. Okay. Outside of business services, you know, there's medical, education, tourism, lots of other jobs that are tradable as well, but I'm not going to talk about those. Workers in tradable business services, not only there are a lot of them, but they are qualitatively different than workers in the rest of the economy. They have much higher educational attainment, so double the rate of college degrees in tradable business services compared to either non-tradable business services or compared to the manufacturing sector. Double the rate of advanced degrees as well. Higher earnings as a result. Okay. Because of this skill intensity in the business service sector, and because the US is still a skill abundant place, the United States has comparative advantage in these attributes. We're good at this stuff. Right? We have globally competitive firms in this space. Services account for 30% of US exports, as best as we know. Yet in spite of strong comparative advantage in services and globally competitive service firms, when we look at service firm participation in the global economy, it significantly lags the manufacturing sector. So if we look at the share of firms that export in manufacturing, it's about 20% of firms export. In services, only 4% export. If we look at exports relative to sales in manufacturing, we export about 20% of manufacturing output. In tradable business services, we only export 4%. So we should be exporting more. Why don't we? The US is a relatively open place. However, the big, fast-growing emerging markets are not. They have much higher barriers to services trade than the United States or the European Union have. What should the US do? Is that my time? That was my time. All right, so I will wrap up. So the United States should aggressively push for services liberalization. The data flows that have been mentioned previously are key. How we're going to do this, TPP seems like a huge lost opportunity. Huge lost opportunity. I don't know where we are on the Trade and International Services Agreement, TISA. I don't know where we are on that. Other developed economies would make natural partners in our effort, in this effort, and the Transatlantic Trade Investment Partnership, if that is still alive, would be a natural place to take some of these issues up. Thank you.
Before we move on much, let me just ask a couple questions. First of all, I'm pleased that you talked about open access. That's fine. That's the place to be. But everybody knows what it means to trade in goods. And you sort of gave some examples of trade in services. What does it really mean to trade in services? What gets counted as an export in services? And how is it counted?
So it's imperfectly measured, right? So the data collection systems for goods and merchandise passes through a port. And because historically we've had tariffs on merchandise, there are administrative systems in place to track. You know, they have to pass through customs. So a form is filed. In services, there is no port. So the Bureau of Economic Analysis has to survey firms to collect information. So they ask firms, how much did you sell abroad? And so, you know, if you're a company like Microsoft, you know, you sell a lot abroad. Or if you're a film distribution company, you sell a lot abroad. Or if you're an architecture firm, you know, you may have clients all over the world. The work is done here in the United States, but it's foreign companies that are paying you for that design work.
So those are so like people watching Moana in another country that's kind of doesn't US export?
When whoever's distributing it in the foreign country pays the United States, that would be, I mean, people don't think about this, but when people from other countries visit Disney World, that's an export of services. Or they visit Las Vegas, or they're taking a Broadway show, Those are all exports and services. Okay, so.
And then maybe, I mean, we can come back to this in a second, but you talk about how important services are and how good those jobs are and how they can grow so quickly even though we don't measure them. And that sort of fits into the general theme that we heard throughout the election, which is that we know that the statistics of the economy are pretty good, and yet everyone thinks everything's terrible. Why is it that manufacturing gets so much more attention?
I'm not a psychiatrist or a sociologist or an anthropologist, so I don't know. I'm befuddled by it. I think it is the fact that there is the cohort in power in this country grew up in an age where what was good for America was what was good for General Motors, what was good for America, what was good for America was good for General Motors. And we think of this halcyon time when American manufacturing firms, you know, conquered the globe. I don't know why. I don't know why. This is the only real thing that I think might be motivating it is manufacturing jobs have provided steady, relatively well-paid employment to low-skilled workers for generations. And it's not clear in a very dynamic, competitive market economy where those people go.
I would just add a thought, and I don't know if this is true, but you know what I have heard mostly about manufacturing jobs is one manufacturing job equals about 3 to 5 additional jobs in the economy. So from what I understand, that has been a driving force in much of the promotion of manufacturing. Is that not so? And can you speak to additional jobs that are popped up in the economy from service jobs? Maybe we don't know enough about that.
So that's a statistic that regional development folks like to talk about.
Yeah.
If we bring a factory here, it'll bring in all these other support jobs. When we think about it at the national level, economists think that's not the right way to think about it. Because if you bring, you know, put it in a plan in a county, you're going to bring in work, you know, people are going to migrate. Where at the national level, we don't think that kind of thing drives immigration. So if you add at the national level, if you're at 5% unemployment like we are now, and let's ignore underemployed workers or discouraged workers, let's say we were at full employment. If you add a manufacturing job, you got to take away a service job. It's not that we somehow add 3 manufacturing jobs. It's if we're going to add a manufacturing job, we have to take away a service job. And I think if you did those studies, if you added a big banking, you know, call center, it would support other jobs too.
It's not to be cynical, but it's also easier to make political campaign commercials with a manufacturing plant in the background than it is a service provider.
Yes, it's on track. So, okay, so Nancy McClure, we've heard from a little bit now. She's the president and CEO of the Organization for International Investment, which represents U.S. subsidiaries of foreign headquartered companies. She focuses on educating legislators on what roles U.S. subsidiaries play in the American economy and policy issues that would make the U.S. a more competitive location for foreign direct investment.
Thank you, Scott, and thank you so much for the opportunity to be here. You know, we talk about the global economy. We never talk enough about cross-border investment, and Ed, you and I have talked about this quite a bit, right? There's such a focus on the trade of goods and services, but actually cross-border investment rivals that in terms of numbers of trade of goods and services. And so, as Scott mentioned, my organization, which has been in existence for 26 years, represents the U.S. operations of companies headquartered abroad. So it's Swiss-based Nestle, Japan-based Toyota, Germany-based Siemens, Samsung, based in Korea. These companies collectively employ about 6.4 million people, and that's just directly. If we think of their supply chains, domestic supply chains, and beyond, they're supporting about 24 million jobs. That's 1 in 7 in the private sector. And it's not just happening in big cities. There's a Canadian-based IT company called CGI, and they have facilities in Lebanon, Virginia, Waterville, Maine, Lafayette, Louisiana. So people in small towns who want to have a high-tech job no longer have to leave their hometown. Lebanon, Virginia, CGI has this fantastic program with the local community college there to help train in high, computer programming people whose families for generations have been doing farming and nothing else. Not that there's anything wrong with farming, it's fantastic. But if you want to leave the farming family, you have other opportunities. And global connections mean that. They mean opportunities that you may not get without them. And foreign direct investment, I think, represents a big part of that. Speaking about manufacturing, about 2 million American workers in the manufacturing space are at U.S. subsidiaries of foreign companies. And I think somewhat counterintuitively, they produce about 26% of all U.S. exports. So we have foreign companies who are making things here with American workers exporting to markets all around the world. So the foreign companies are here not only making things for our market, but also for around the world. I think the number one and number two largest car exporters has been Daimler and BMW back and forth over the years. So the way we think about us versus them has changed. You know, we talked about technological changes. Well, there's also been dramatic changes in the global business environment. And, we don't have all that represented when we're just talking about trade. Jobs at U.S. subsidiaries tend to be much higher compensated, on average about 33% higher, with the average U.S. worker making over $80,000 a year. And that's typically not because they're paying the same worker, the same job more, right? It's actually because the types of jobs that these companies create tend to be in the higher skill area. So these are the jobs that help support a family. These are the jobs that, I know I have three kids, I want my kids to be able to get one of those jobs. And if you look at the growth of employment, foreign company related jobs in the US from 2009 to 2014 have grown by 20%, where jobs in the overall private economy have grown by only 8%. So again, it doesn't require a really complex math equation to understand how foreign direct investment benefits the U.S. workforce. And when we think about the competitiveness of the U.S., we're no longer in that space where we can just say, well, how competitive are our American champions? How important is it for Boeing or Hershey to compete around the world more so than Airbus and Nestle to grow jobs in the United States? Again, this challenge of who is us and who is them. There's a lot of R&D going on here in the US, and foreign companies are hiring American engineers and scientists to do. They represent about 17% of all research and development going on in the United States, and they do some really cool stuff. German-based Bayer has this incubator facility in Mission Bay, California, in the San Francisco area. And it's called the Co-Laborator, and they have all these small businesses that are coming to the Co-Laborator to get access to Bayer's global expertise, and they are developing all sorts of amazing technology right here in the United States. I heard my buzzer. But I wanted to flag that when you listen to the specific details about the companies that we're talking about here, there's really not too much foreign about them. And getting people to understand that the competitiveness of our workforce is what we need to focus on, regardless of who is employing them. When we think about how do we make the U.S. more competitive, it's about our workforce and our economy, and not sort of old views of who is us and who is them.
So just a quick question. So as an economist, it's hard for you to think of FDI as anything but good. But you're sort of implying that when people hear about foreign companies in the US, the impression is not necessarily always positive. that they think this is somehow a problem? Is that one of the sort of myths that you have to dispel?
Yeah, so it's kept me employed for 26 years. So, because I started this organization in 1990. And at the time, there was the book and the movie The Rising Sun, if anyone is old enough in this room to remember that, where Japan was coming in and buying us up, right? And what there was this, academic, I think she was a George Washington, who kept saying that the Japanese were coming. It was like inviting the Japanese over for dinner and they were stealing our silverware. Right? So, you know, and that we'd all be wearing white uniforms and doing exercises, and Japanese exercises in the morning. And, you know, I think the word foreign itself scares people. You know, if you look it up in the dictionary, it means strange. Right? So, I think that there is misconception about what foreign companies do in the United States once they're here. For many years, there was a concern they were just screwdriver jobs. They were coming here, they were supported by their governments. I mean, not to give you the counter talking points, but they always say don't repeat the negative, but I'll just give you an example. You know, that they're supported by their governments, and they come to the United States, and they drive out U.S. business and U.S. workers. Well, none of that has turned out to be so. What's interesting is that, and perhaps if I was a domestic competitor, I might do this as well, sometimes use it as a wedge issue in sort of the competition for government contracts and other things. When the Cash for Clunkers bill was originally introduced, if we remember during the beginning of the Great Recession, it was written so that in order to qualify, your car had to be manufactured at a facility that had been in the United States at least 40 years. Shockingly, Honda, which was the longest operating in the US global automaker, had been here 39 years. Who would have thought? So some of these things are insidious. There's not big I hate foreign company bills anymore. There were, but there is a lot of misconception about it. And you know, these companies are proud of their global heritage, but they're invested here for the long term. And you know, many of them just view themselves as any other domestic company.
Okay, our final panelist is Ed Berwin, who is the Senior Fellow for Trade and Global Opportunity at the Progressive Policy Institute. He focuses on the role of trade in supporting economic growth and good jobs for Americans. He also provides trade policy advice to companies and organizations as President of Trade Unions.
Thank you, Scott, and I'm the final contestant in Scott's version of Beat the Clock, so I'll do my best. I'd like to take a few minutes today to highlight how global connections help small businesses to trade. If you go back 25 years before the internet and you were a small company and you wanted to export, you had to jump through lots of hoops. You maybe had to hire lawyers and consultants, draft contracts, get letters of credit, and maybe get on an airplane and make a number of foreign visits. Now, if you fast forward to today, you're talking about a small company that is digitally, globally connected, trade can be a heck of a lot easier. You can use the internet to find information about markets and rules and customers. You can sell on eBay and Etsy. You can get paid by PayPal and Google Wallet. And you can use UPS and FedEx to deliver your goods, clear them through customs, and track those shipments all along the way. That has been hugely transformative to many globally connected small businesses. And the proof is really in the data. If you look at small businesses, regular traditional small businesses in the United States, about 5% of those companies are exporters. If you look at exporters who are digitally connected on the eBay platform, the comparable number is 97%. And most of those companies sell to 10 or more different foreign markets. So the internet and global connections has been hugely transformative to these companies. It's also helped these companies grow more quickly. Traditionally, if you were a small company and you wanted to export, maybe you started in this market and you slowly grew to other markets. Today, with the internet, if you're a small company, you can literally be born global on day one. You can sell to everybody in the world. You can be a micro multinational. So, for example, there was a company a few years ago called Black Label, an online tailoring company. In its very first year, through the internet, it sold to 74 different countries. And eBay reports that its average exporter sells to 18 different countries in a single year. Now, the final way that these connections can help small businesses to trade is that it can level the playing field. It can democratize trade for small companies. You don't necessarily anymore have to be a big company with far-flung offices and teams of lawyers and consultants. You can go toe-to-toe with the big guys in many ways because of these global connections. Now, these global connections for small businesses also can play a very important role in helping the American economy. Anything we can do to help small business is vitally important for our economy, because 2 out of 3 net new jobs in the United States are created by and supported by small businesses. And if you look at small businesses that export, they are real economic powerhouses. They grow faster, they're more profitable, they're more resilient, they hire many more workers, and they pay much higher salaries than small businesses that don't export. And this is true across all kinds of demographic groups. I think it was mentioned, I think Congressman Royce mentioned the fact that these connections can be a source for inclusion. Well, if you look at small businesses owned by women, by minority groups, by young people, and by veterans, all of those companies do a lot better, and they support more better-paying jobs when they export. Now, there's also a lot of evidence that we can further grow small business exporting, particularly exporting that's digitally enabled. Surveys by the National Small Business Association show that a majority of small businesses that don't export would be interested in exporting if we could do more to get them in foreign markets, because they understand that's where the growth is. And if you look at small businesses owned by younger Americans, by millennials, 75% of those companies already sell their products and services over the internet. So it's not a big jump for them to go global. Pretty close. I'd just like to conclude by saying that if we're going to help these small companies grow, and we're going to help digitally enabled small business trade contribute to the American economy, we have to do some of the things that our prior speakers have mentioned, and that is get our policy right on issues like the free flow of data across border and knocking down barriers to both digital and traditional trade. Thank you.
Most of the examples you gave were small businesses engaged in trading of goods, right? How do they split along with the goods services?
You know, I don't know the breakdown, but I did a paper last November in which we highlighted the great variety of small businesses that trade. There were companies that made chemicals and electrical products. There were companies that provided management consulting services across borders. There was one company called Sheer ID, which literally provides software solutions for e-commerce. You know, you get discounts sometimes if you went to a certain college or if you're a member of the military. Well, this company had a very sophisticated program that would help all kinds of digital merchants check on people, you know, whether they went to Columbia University or whether they were in the Marines, without disturbing the privacy of the individuals involved. And they were a vastly very quickly growing company. So there is a lot in the services sector. There is a lot in the technology sector. I know app developers, for example, something like 88% of app developers, the largest 500 app developers are all small businesses. So this digital enabling really affects, you know, it's only limited by the imagination of the small business in terms of creating products and services.
So I just want to make the point that we don't know, because we don't measure it. So we measure goods trade well. We know what farms do and we know what factories do. But we don't measure services trade well. And remember, services is 8% of the economy. This is a huge gap in our collective knowledge. It hampers policy. We have no idea what the impact of trade agreements are on the service sector. So we are really shooting in the dark. And just to emphasize it, you know, what data there is that's collected by the Census Bureau of BEA suggests that small firms really don't export. Small service firms don't export. I've been working with PayPal to look at some of their data, and again, the industry classification is very different. It's a credit card transaction, but it suggests, like the data that Ed is referring to, that most export, and most export to many countries. But in official statistics, you just don't see that. We have no idea. And that's a huge problem.
And one of the other things that I think we tend to lose track of sometimes, and it also goes to the data, is there are a lot of companies, particularly small companies, who export indirectly. You know, they're part of the supply chain of some big company, but they are just as dependent as the big company on foreign markets, because ultimately that's where their products or services end up.
We'll take questions in just one second. We'll just ask one more thing. Nancy, are your members worried about the environment in the U.S. and that do some consider the possibility that they may be harder to invest in the U.S.?
So global companies are most competitive in environments that have global connections, right? So the more trade agreements, the more, right, that we are, you know, can trade goods and services cross borders, these companies excel. They also care a lot about domestic supply chain. So about 79 cents of every dollar spent on inputs is with domestic supply chains, right? But it's not a zero sum. Those global supply chains matter as well. So the current environment, I think what is most problematic is the uncertainty. You know, how are they going to be treated here? I think that multinational companies, both in the United States and all around the world, are dealing with the fact that globalization has become the fall guy for all of our economic problems, right? So we've mentioned automation, connectivity, the fact that you can sell things over the internet has displaced workers as well. The fact that you've got majority groups who are now turning into minorities are scary people, terrorism. All of these things, I think, represent the new political dynamic, and globalization itself has become the fall guy. And companies all over the world are trying to figure out how to fit into this new environment, and the uncertainty right now is pretty steep.
Hi, Ken Levinson with the Washington International Trade Association. Sort of a question for Brad a little bit, but with the advent of some new technologies, things like 3D printing, how is that going to be quantified as an import or an export? If you had, say, a brake part that's designed in Japan, was previously maybe manufactured in Mexico, components, I don't know where all the parts came from across the border, maybe some part of it was an import. In the future, maybe that design still takes place. There's raw goods inputs that go into it, but it's manufactured in Baltimore, distributed on the East Coast. How is that going to be measured in the future? Is an import an export? What?
I have no idea.
Okay.
So I think it's an important question. And it's not the future, it's now.
Right.
Right? We have semiconductor design firms, you know, that are factoryless here in the United States. They design semiconductors. They ship the design to a fab in Taiwan. The semiconductors are produced in Taiwan. They're shipped to an assembly factory somewhere in China. and then that consumer electronic, whatever the ultimate product is shipped all over the world. I honestly don't know how that intellectual, because it's an intellectual property flow, right? It's something that's designed here, but because I don't know who owns, you know, what's being produced in Taiwan, I don't know whether it would be an export or an import of manufacturing services, and then how the assembly in China would be treated. I'm pretty knowledgeable about the national income and product accounts, but I'm not an expert, or not the expert, and I think that they are struggling, you know, the statistical system is struggling with this to know how to capture all the value, right? All the value that are created by investments in tangibles in this country, not only by American firms, but by the Siemens and, you know, the global firms that come here because we have a talented workforce and an innovative ecosystem. And how we capture, you know, my guess is we're missing a lot of it.
Well, I think statistics overall, as you said, I mean, you were asking that, well, you don't know who owns the company overseas, you know, does that factor into whether it's an import or an export? I remember getting into a heated conversation with a staffer in the Senate over whether Siemens exports from the U.S. should be counted as U.S. exports, right? Because of course they should be counted as U.S. exports.
The U.S. people are making them.
But I think there is a lot of confusion about statistics overall, not only some of the really very complex questions that you raised, Ken, but also some of the ideological issues around that, still trying to look back to 1970, us versus them, and, you know, who owns what.
And I think, Ken, your point also underscores the real importance of us making sure that we have good global rules on things like data flows, because this is, as Brad says, it's now, but it's also the future. I profiled a young woman in Brooklyn in a prior report by the name of Mary Wong. She is a shoe designer. She has created an entire line of 3D printable high fashion shoes. She's a small business person, and her vision is eventually you go into a high-end boutique in London, you want one of her shoes, they scan your foot, out of the machine comes this, you know, small business created, digitally enabled shoe. So it's a very important question, not only in terms of measurement, but in terms of where the economy is going.
What do you think? Do you think that's an
export? That's a fantastic product, by the way.
She only has women's shoes, as far as I can tell. So I'll reserve judgment. I don't know. I mean, I would defer to Brad on how to measure it, but it's trade of some sort. And my view is, you know, aside from how we have to measure it, we have to make sure that we're enabling it and making sure that people who do it, small businesses and others in the United States, have pathways for that.
This is one reason why we talk about global connections. Okay, to get away from having to make these kind of fine parsing of is this exports, is that, we know what it is. It's somebody who is doing work that is valued by the global economy, that is getting paid for. Okay? Do we have to decide whether it's an import, an export, or an alien? No, we don't have to. We know that it's valuable for us and valuable for the global economy, and it depends on being able to connect it with other countries. And that's why we kind of want to move away from the trade categories, the question you asked is exactly right. The categories don't fit anymore. And we can't make them fit.
Which is one reason that the border adjustable tax is that much more difficult, right?
It highlights, you know, why data flows are important, right? If that customer information of the person who bought the shoe couldn't come to the United States, but it was forced to be localized within the country because of privacy rules or some other regulation, that business is done. So, I mean, that there are no data provisions in any big trade agreement that we have is a problem.
Hi, my name is Anne. I have a question for Nancy. Are any of your member companies worried about the discussion on visa regulation changes, like H-1B, for instance?
Yes. But I would say it's not just my companies, right? So all companies that are looking for certain skill sets that they're having difficulties finding in the United States care about that issue. It's certainly not just my companies.
So I'm Carl Schoenander from SIA. I have a question for Brad. I was fascinated by your discussion about what gets counted, how it gets counted, because what gets counted has consequences politically. I'm wondering, in order to get a better picture on what services mean for the U.S. economy and our trade picture, to get the Census Bureau and other institutions to count this or do more work on this, do we need legislation? Or what do we need to remedy this, in your view?
So I don't know if it's legislation, but Commerce has to do something about the allocation of activity. The Department of Commerce has to do something about the allocation of activities between the Bureau of Economic Analysis and the Census Bureau. So BEA has historically collected information on trade and services. It started doing this, I think, when trade and services were a very small share of trade, and it was only because they were interested in producing the national income and product accounts. There was a cell in the national income and product accounts that said trade and services. So they needed to put something in that cell. So they would survey, 200 firms, the biggest service firms, and provide an estimate. And at the time when they started doing this, it didn't matter. But now it does. And I don't think they have any more resources to collect that information. BEA has no sample frame. The way our balkanized statistical system is set up, they don't have access to tax return information to produce a statistically representative sample frame like the Census Bureau does. And BEA has this tiny survey unit that collects information on multinationals, both U.S. multinationals and foreign affiliates, or affiliates of foreign multinationals in the United States, and it collects information on trade and services. I think it's crazy. The Census Bureau should do all of it. They send forms to everybody. They have, it's a big time data collection operation. Why this persists, I have no idea. Maybe there's a staffer in this room who can fix it. I don't think it would cost a ton of money to get better service statistics and better service trade statistics. It would just take a little re-engineering. And that we're not doing it is, it's shame on us.
All right, so before the Capitol Police kick us out, please join me in thanking the panelists for helping me.